Yo, what up with it? What's going on? You are now listening to Sports with Truck and Chubby. Let's go. Comfort a rat. If you're on YouTube watching me, man, go ahead and hit that like button one time for me, man. Subscribe to the channel if you're new here. If you listen to me on Pod, give me all 5 stars. Give me a couple of them. You know what I mean? Leave me a good review, man. Let me know on ways I can improve. And some of the topics you might want to talk about, man, because I'm checking them as frequently as I can. Supposed to be dropping weekly episodes, but I'm bringing them to you even more. So, hey, I'm out here working, man. Congratulate y'all, man. Appreciate y'all up out there watching me and tuning in also. So shout out to Coach Hayes, man. Shout out to you, man. I was definitely checking it out today. I didn't get to watch last night. I got to get up at 4:30 in the morning, dog. So I can't be doing the late shows. He said he was going to cook me. I texted him. I said, I'm going to cook you, Coach. He said, young man, I'm the Waffle House chef. I said, oh, man. Waffle, you know that Waffle House be hitting different. So I said, you know what? I said, I'm just a line prep cook. I don't even think I want no smoke, Coach. I was just playing. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, that's my dog, man. That's my dog. You know, like I always say, man, he's always been there for me for words of advice and ways to improve and everything else, man. So shout out to you, Coach. Shout out to everybody working, man. Shout out to David Talks Bus, man. He out there doing his thug. Dizzle right now, you know what I'm saying? See everybody working hard, raw hat and all them. I worked with them in the past. Hopefully we could, you know, get up on something, because we got some explaining to do. You heard me? Yeah, Colorado Buffalo talk now. But look, so we all know that the Colorado Buffaloes was recently all up in the news and everything before I get up into this video that I want to play and everything else. So I already addressed it once, but for some reason, you know, it's circulating a lot. And you would think that things that matter more will circulate rather than lies. So that just goes to show you how much a lie matters out here and is worth more clickbait than the hard truth of a matter. You know what I'm saying? Like, no matter how hard of a critic I've been on Colorado, at the same time, I have no problem with giving them their props when props is due, okay? And they're not the only, I'm going to call out BS when I see BS, you know what I'm saying? So in this case, so there has been rumors. And it was supposed to be a credible sport source, according to Athlon Sports. Like, why would you put out some BS news? Like, why? Mr. Steve Corder. And then, like, you put it on nobody. Nobody, there's no face to it, no anything. So me and my co-host, like I said, we went over it on a fan's point of view. If you missed that episode, you've been under a rock and you definitely need to go back and watch it. But he actually said something about, what if Bucky just made this up? What if Bucky just made this up? They already have their own media. So let's just say, you know, tinfoil hat on, whatever you want to call it out there, whatever y'all calling it nowadays. Hypothetically speaking, I would say that Bucky, Deion Sanders Jr. called him and said, look, we were mandatory to go. Now they're in the news again. And with all due respect, you know, following football, college football, you got the hard knocks in the NFL, just like Coach Hayes was talking about last night. You made a good point there too, sir. And I got to follow up on that. Instead of comment, and I'll make a video. That's what I am, a content creator, right? So Colorado give us the news, right? And when things ain't going on, we got news to report on. Shout out to Colorado for that, too. You know what I'm saying? They're always giving us something to talk about in the college football space. It's a gift and a curse of that, right? Because you're always giving us something to talk about. So that means that people are always going to talk about something and you're always going to be in the news. And I wish that some people would notice that and they're purposely doing that and they can handle that. But when you're putting out lies and you're supposed to be a credible source like this, that's kind of wild to me. Like, and I'm like, put a name on it. You can't validate any of this. especially when you're a beat writer for any sports magazine, online magazine, you can't do that. You shouldn't do that. It's a bad look for you and not on the coach. Now, I must say that they're trying to mount distractions. And I heard people talk about, and I heard a gentleman called in last night, the coach, hey, so he talked about it might have been for the recruiting purposes. I've also seen comments online about people trying to attack Colorado for the recruiting services. So it's not the first time that I've heard that. I've heard that a lot. And I've also heard that they're trying to distract Colorado from things that's going on. And I hope that that's not the case. I'm going to dive into some other things today. I'm going to talk, but I want to address this first. Now, we don't actually know where this came from. Could have been a setup or whatever else it is. Now, the fact that this would gain more traction than other things that had been out there, to me, just goes to show how society works, how we work as people, as humans, and where our minds are. You know what I mean? Like, it's pretty sad when you look at it the way that it is. Like, to be honest, like, even me myself, I've been called a Colorado hater, or whatever else, jumped online. I like to say that we was just in down south, Jonin, boondocking. Some people call it that. We call it ripping up here, and that's just what it was. You know what I mean? So I got ripped on by my peers online, up on the spaces and so forth and so on for it. And it was all in fun. You know what I mean? And some of it was accountability, like, why you feel this way, but you really don't. So, you know, whatever else it is, but I just don't understand why it would come down to this. And it's backfired, right? It backfired. Let's just call it what it is. It definitely backfired, without a doubt. Shots fired because problems at USC. What is going on at USC with Lincoln Riley right now? What is going on? Oh, my goodness. We, like, recruits are leaving. Decommit. Like, what is decommit? What is that? Like, you know, the definition of decommit is that no longer commit, like it's no longer committing or committed, because they're using this decommit word strongly. And I guess when you try to look it up in a definition, as a definition, as me typing out decommit, okay, it doesn't seem like a word. Okay, I guess it's to withdraw from a commitment or a agreed course of action. Decommitted. Okay, so it is in the American English Collins Dictionary. It is in the Collins Dictionary now, okay? So when you're saying decommitted, it has to be decommitted. Not decommit. Decommitted is the word that we're looking for here. To withdraw from a commitment or an agreed course of action. That's what that is. Okay. So these young men right now, and by the way, y'all gonna want to tune in, Fans Point of View, 8 p.m. this Friday, because we're gonna get into it. The theme is development dollars. You heard? We're gonna get into it. It's gonna be some good, it's gonna be a good one. Most definitely, because we're going to get into a lot of, you know, we're at the young level basketball, young men in football. We're going to touch on a lot of that. So I'm not really going to address it now, but I'm just warming y'all up. Okay, I'm marinating the situation right now, because these young men, what is their goals? What are they going after? What is their outcome? And better yet, where's the parents? What is the parents doing in this situation? What is their end goal? Why is, and I'm going to say this, but I'm going to touch on other things. Why is education the back burner for sports with these parents. I understand you have a 4 or 5 star athlete that can get NIL dollars and everything else. And mind you, it's name, image, and likeness. If you have a 4 or 5 star athlete, you have all their film parents, you start a channel or their social media, you gain traction off of that, you post their highlights, whatever else you need to do. After you get up a following, you look attractive to sponsors, to other, you know what I mean? And then that's how you build up off of that. You don't really need to, you know, put their education to the side and seem like some helicopter parent, some parent who don't want to work or whatever it is, and everything else. And I have to touch on this, and sometimes I get sidetracked, but I'm going somewhere right now and I feel like I'm hitting on something and I must say it. Parents, and there's been a big narrative with a lot of people out there who are in these professional spaces. And by me being a parent, I know how much sacrifice you have to give up and the things you sacrifice to make sure that your kid gets to their games on time, the cost of the game, the fundraisers, etc., the equipment, the things that the kids want, because they just don't want regular cleats, okay? They want the Deion cleats. They want the 96 Air Max cleats. They want the Jordan cleats. You know what I mean? Okay? They just don't want regular basketball shoes. They want the Jordans. They want the Currys. They want the Kyrie. They want whatever, the LeBrons. They want expensive things. And if they're doing what they're supposed to do in school, and in their sport, us as parents provide those things, right? Because they're doing what they're supposed to do. They've been doing their chores and bringing home good grades and listening well to mom and dad, whatever that may be. So if they're doing their job correctly, and I understand that, we may spoil them. But is that being spoiled if they're doing their job? I don't think so. I don't think so. If you're bringing home the good grades, respectful at school, no trouble, respectful at home, chores, how can I deny you something as a parent? I can't. And that's just how I feel. That's just me, though. That's me. If you're doing all that, you're okay. But that whole narrative of parents wanting to live off their children, I have to rebuttal this, and I must come at people who feel this way. Why would you feel like a parent needs to live off their child when they sacrifice their life, and not their life, but, you know, in a sense they have, right? And sacrifice so much to make sure their child had the best trainers, the whatever it was, to get their child to that level. And now that their child has finally made it, they no longer could be a part of their life. That makes no sense to me. So now they're just supposed to let their child get chewed up in a system that doesn't care about nobody. This, the system of boxing, of football, basketball, I don't care what sport it is. None of nobody cares about nothing but themselves. So now you're just supposed to let your child, and they will forever be your child. That will forever be your baby. No matter how old they are, they will always be your child. They would always had come from you. You always would have conceived them. They came up out of you, and then they came out the mom. So, you know, this is, I'm talking like that because I'm on YouTube right now, but y'all know where I'm getting at with this. So, how, and I understand there's parents that are over the top, but are they just looking out for the best interest of their child, or are they being greedy? Now there's a difference, right? There's a big difference with that to me. Because I know there's some out there, but that also do know that there's a lot of parents out here. And for your child to get that to that point, they've done so much. And you always got these business people and these some of these professionals, these parents. And I get it. I get it. I'm a youth coach. I get it. The parents can be annoying. I was one of them up until, you know what I mean? I was really start seeing how it is. You know, you have volunteer sheets and you're passing and they always say, who wants to be a volunteer parent? You sign up. Nobody else does. They keep sending emails weeks before the season start. Nobody signs up. But now here come game time. Nobody showed up to practice. Five, six kids, game time baseball. Every parent wants to be a coach. Do this, do that. Why? This is not what I'm teaching your child. If you thought you could do better, then why didn't you sign up to be the volunteer coach or a volunteer assistant coach or a volunteer whatever? Why didn't you do that? Nobody does these things. Nobody does these things. And I get it. I understand. But and when you're at the professional level or you're leading up to that, in a semi-professional level, it can be annoying. I get it. And that at some point, but there is that mama bear, papa bear mentality that we have with our children that will never leave. And I'm not going to let my child get swallowed up in a system that does not care about him or her. That won't happen. So no, they're not supposed to. So when you professionals out there get to talking about these parents, get into detail with that. Because just don't make a general statement on that and say, well, these parents just want to live off their child. Well, they've been taking care of their child up until that point. It's not fair to say that. I don't think it's fair to say that. I honestly don't. Because they have provided for that child. You didn't. And when you're a coach, an assistant coach, a part of a staff, a team mom, a team dad, whatever you may be, we go into these situations knowing this and having to understand that we're going to be dealing with those situations. That's just how it is. So you can't blame a parent for being a certain way. Now, will greediness get you? Of course. Now, I know I went way off here, the reservation, and I got into that because it's just something that it just came up and I said, I got to get it out because these professionals sometimes they get in these spaces and they use the same tools that we use and they constantly discredit us. And I think that there's a space for professionals to meet the average Joe behind a microphone and for us to have conversations, because I do think that there's very good content creators out here that can keep up with these professionals. And just because you can name and all the decades of sports and names doesn't make you better than anybody out here. Because people are on the front lines out here. I would say I'm on the front line out here as a content creator. I am. I haven't found that spot yet where I'm at in coasting. I'm out here on the front lines. So where you're at comfortably in having your speech taken away because you're using sponsors that if you speak freely on, they'll take your platform away in a heartbeat. So I get it, but we just got to stop sometimes. It's not going to stop, but I would hope that people can get better in understanding that part of it. And once you as a coach or recruiter understand that, the better, the underway you understand that and know how to maneuver around this parent or parents, I think that'd make it better. But I don't know what's going on with Lincoln Riley. in the USC right now. It's falling apart. And if this was Deion Sanders, people would be all over this right now. All over it. Every sports channel, content creator. So to be fair, I gotta come at SC. What is going on? Do you not know? And see, you have to retain your talent, and they're not doing that there right now. I don't know what's going on. If kids are not in the plan, I thought them being in the Big Ten, it would make a lot of players want to travel to SC. I can go stay in California, play football, and also come back home to play Michigan or Ohio State. And it's not working the way that everybody thought it might. Losing some recruits to quarterback. I have no clue what's going on. But when I find out, I'm going to jump on it, because it's, like I said, you got to give it equally out here. If I'm going to give it to this person, I got to give it to that one. Can't pick and choose on the people you want to get at and not do it. If you're going to start doing that, you got to finish it. Finish your plate. Eat your vegetables. And don't get up till they gone. So when I found out more upon what's going on with USC, best believe, it'd be there. But see, they don't put everything out, so you can't even really speculate and give a fair opinion on what might be going on. But if they're decommitting, then that shit might be going down. And I didn't honestly think that SC would probably be a top notch. I didn't think that SC would be a top notch Big Ten team. I think they're hovering in that mid tier range in the Big Ten right now. For me, anyway, that's just me and how I feel. I didn't think that they were a top tier, but if you can retain your talent, must be some problems. There's something going on at SC that recruits don't like, or parents don't like, somebody don't like something that's going on. Now, finally, I'll get up into it. We are about to go into this on X. Now, Antonio Brown just had recently went on a pivot, and it's been circulating around. Ben Roethlisberger was the only reason why he started for the Steelers. He told Bruce Arians, "I need you to go to the X." Now, I got a little clip here. I think I could play it, so let's play.
And Ryan Clark know my relationship with Bruce Arians. How many years you know Bruce Arians to hold me back?
It was a while.
Ben Roethlisberger, the only reason I even start starting for the Steelers. Literally, he had to go tell Bruce Arians, like, yo, I need AB at the X.
Oh, crazy. He told him that. Now, even me being a Steelers fan, I was shocked when I heard this. I was like, oh my goodness, like, is this true? Like, so, you know, in Pittsburgh, growing up in Pittsburgh, and the way Pittsburgh is a certain type of way, right? For people who don't know, this is true. You could look it up. Back in the 90s, they let the KKK marched through downtown Pittsburgh, block streets off, put big fences up, let them march through downtown Pittsburgh. And if that tells you anything about that city, that's it. So when it comes to being a Steelers fan, it brings everybody together, right? It just does. And that's the beautiful thing about being a Steelers fan. The one and this newer generation of Steelers fans is even more, how could I put this, culturally accepted? You know what I mean? Like, they're more diverse. This new generation of Steelers fan is more diverse than the old Steelers fan, right? In the way that the Steelers were back then. Now, the Steelers organization has always been looked at. If you ask any real person from Pittsburgh, there's a lot of people that litter that's not fans of the Steelers. And the reason of being, you would think that, you know, the whole city is just Steelered out. And for the most part, it is. But they have their reasons. You know what I mean? And I can't. I'm not saying that. I'm not race baiting here. I'm just trying to say. I'm trying to get to a point here and saying that there's two different kinds of Steelers fans. I mean, that's probably with every fan base, right? I'm sure of it. You know what I mean? But you wouldn't think that with such a prestigious organization like how Pittsburgh is, we mainly keep things in house and we clean it up in house. Bruce Arians was loved by a certain Steeler fan. Okay, so that's where I'm going with that. And look, I'm just speaking on my team. I can't speak for whatever else organization, and I'm sure it's everywhere. But look, it is what it is. But one thing that I've noticed with this is that when you don't talk about things, is and you don't bring certain things up and bring certain things to light, that might be the best way to handle in some things. But in some cases, speaking on things helps. There's some people that helps. There is people out there who rather just deal with things, keep it silent, and keep it moving. However, there is people that need words, confirmation. They need to hear this. They need to hear things and talk it out. And there's nothing wrong with that neither. But we have to understand that's the way it is. Now, I'm saying all this to say that Bruce Arians, there was always rumblings about Bruce Arians and the way that he was on the team. Now, it took a Ben Roethlisberger to step up to Bruce Arians and say, look, no, I need Antonio Brown. And as you can see, if you go watch the episode of The Pivot, that's what he was on, guest starring on The Pivot with Ryan Clark and Channing Tatum and Big Fred, you know what I'm saying? So when you go watch this episode, you'll probably find out, you'll be able, I can't play the whole thing, you know, for copyright purposes and so forth. But you'll see Ryan Clark's, the way that he's responding to this and looking at Antonio Brown, why he's talking like this and he's confirming it. Like, yeah, we know how this team is. And we knew how the team was and, you know, and things was going with him. That's why one of the reasons why he's not sticking around in Pittsburgh is because of the way that things was going with him. Okay. Now, he was great in Pittsburgh, don't get me wrong, but the Rooneys is a family who don't tolerate the ignorance of that. And if you were ignorant with the Rooneys, they'll pretty much put you on display. They'll probably kick you out the stadium if you display any acts of unkindness towards another person or another race. The Rooneys, they're just not like that. In the sense that they won't tolerate it. They're not Italian. They are an Irish family. And they don't play no games. I like the Rooneys. They're cool. I mean, they got a whole rule named after them. So, I mean, and I'm not saying that they're not strong or whatever they believe or whatever that's going on, but I'm saying that they don't tolerate bull crap and BS from people. That's all I'm saying about the Rooneys, all right? So I'll keep it moving. Keep it moving. Next one, your top five. And any comments, anywhere you just think about your top five Heisman candidates. Miami is on every list right now. Hurricanes fans, stand up. Stand up, Hurricanes fans. Y'all on a lot of lists. A lot of lists right now. I mean, it's almost crazy to what every list you go and look on. Top five list from this list is from what On Three. You go to PFF, they're on all kinds of lists, and I'm gonna get up into that. So if you're on YouTube, you could definitely see it right now. YouTube channel, the same thing as it is right now. If you listen to me on pod, if you are on YouTube watching me, if you want to catch me on the pod, you don't want to watch, same thing. Sports with Truck and Chubby, all right, all platforms. So if you're still sticking with me this long, obviously you messing with me, you rocking with me, hit that like button. Hit it. Help me out in the algorithm. Leave a comment. Let me know what's up. So the number one quarterback they got for Heisman candidate, and it's, I mean, you can put it in any order you want to, Cam Ward, Miami University. They is hyping Miami up. There's big expectations for Miami to perform. Big expectations. Cam Ward is a great quarterback. I heard a lot of people comparing Shador to him and saying he beat Shador. Could he do it this year? We don't know because they didn't play. They don't play this year, but last year they played. And to be honest, I did not think that Colorado would lose to Washington State. No way, no how. Washington State put up 56 points on them, hung 56, and Cam Ward was their quarterback, spinning it like crazy. He can move. He's athletic. He was going to go into the draft, decided to go to Miami instead, kind of played around with the Miami fans a little bit. I understand that. But Cam Ward is absolutely a cannon, and he is definitely – he definitely should be on this list. Would I put him number one over these quarterbacks? Preston Stone and Cam Ward – they right there for me, but Preston Stone is on the list. So we'll talk about him. He's at number five, and then I'll go back. So Cam Ward's number one. I know I'm not going in order and because I'm different and I'm unorthodox like that. I'm different. But since I already mentioned Preston Stone, y'all know the SMU quarterback. Man, this kid, man, is a cannon, bro. I rocks with Preston Stone. Preston Stone, I like what he put up on film. He can make all the throws. He'll be in the ACC. And by the way, there's four. Okay, so all these quarterbacks are the ACC quarterbacks candidates. Let me clear that up, because I was about to say, hold on, let me make that clear. So they're new to the ACC. They're one of the favorites to take it already just by the play of him. But I'm concerned with their offensive line. I'm a little concerned with that when it comes to that and what's going to go on there. Riley Leonard from Notre Dame, to be in the ACC top five, I guess when you get to looking at the quarterbacks around the ACC, should Riley Leonard be in there from Notre Dame? I would say so. I guess it's fair to put him in. I don't know. Maybe Hayes King. I'm just saying. But I guess you got to put him there. He's a Notre Dame quarterback. Good program. Decent receivers. Good running game. And so you got to put him up there, right? Because they're going to win. And that's what some of this is about. This next quarterback I'm about to talk to you about. Number three, North Carolina State. Grayson McCall, man, Coastal Carolina last year, him being at North Carolina State, I had done a video on North Carolina State spring game. Man, let me tell you, they ran the ball so effectively. And I know it's just a spring game, but running backs are live in spring games, okay? And they do the old-fashioned spring game. They don't do the 7-on-7. They do, we're hitting, you're live. What I saw out of North Carolina State was a very unselfish football team. It does not look like they brought in transfers from other schools. It didn't look like that to me. And I know it's a lot of people say it's only a spring game. They don't count. It's not a real game. I'm looking at the things they will do to another team, such as the receivers that were blocking when they weren't getting the ball. They were full sprint, acting like they were running a route, distracting the receivers for the running back to open up a hole for a running back. So it froze the linebackers, and about time the linebackers, recognized it was run. The running back was in his face. Things like that help a team win. It's the little things on a football field that matter.
I think it's the little they say it's the little things in life that matter, right? That's just so. If we take that same concept and you put it on a football field, what's the little things in football that matter? Things like that, unselfishness, unselfish plays. And when I saw North Carolina State do these things, I said, oh my goodness. And not only was it one running back. No, it wasn't two running back. No. Anybody they put in the backfield was running the ball well. So if they can even give 60% of what they have shown in that spring game, if they take that same mentality they had in that spring game, apply it to the regular season, North Carolina State will do damage in the ACC. How much? I can't call right now, but they will. And with Grayson McCall, quarterback, what I saw from him was patience. Patience. That's what I saw from him. If we gotta run the ball, we'll run the ball. I'm looking for the right read. I saw receivers blocking, offensive line blocking. I like what I saw up out of the Wolfpack. I did. Virginia Tech quarterback Kaeron Jones. He's the last one on that. We're talking about number four when it comes down to that. Now, him and Virginia Tech, I've seen Virginia Tech do Tulane the craziest. Kaeron Jones. Now, if I'm not mistaken, Kaeron Jones first, I think, did he start off at Baylor? He started off at Baylor, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. Now, y'all could correct me if I'm wrong or whatever. What's going on? And he is just a dynamic quarterback. He reminds me of Jalen Hurts. I'm going to say that. He's growing on me. Virginia Tech's quarterback, Kaeron Jones, is growing on me. Kaeron Jones is definitely growing on me. He reminds me of Jalen Hurts, man. Like, if you saw him in that bowl game. Now, I get it. It's Tulane. Oh, it's Tulane, the green wave. We have to start putting some respect on these elite G5 programs. Now, do I still believe G5 should have their own playoff system? Absolutely. Absolutely. Because the elite of the elite in the G5 should definitely be meeting each other. I'm talking North Dakota State, South Dakota State, Montana, Missouri State, Tulane. When it comes down to playoff, we need to see that. That would be exciting football. Because these guys in the G5 programs, and you got to start thinking of the NIL value. I know I'm going here. I go going off the reservoir again, but stay with me. These G5 programs, and with the NIL being the way it is nowadays, these G5 programs don't have money to offer you. But what they do have to offer you is an authentic college experience and development into being a great football player. And if I'm lying, you look at the way the NFL drafted, they have to draft big names. Why? Because for publicity. But immediately, almost immediately after that, these coaches get the draft done and over with, but they already have their undrafted list already made out before. Let's go. That's where the real talent gets picked at. If you ask me, things I've been evaluating, the real talent gets picked undrafted. Yeah, we'll see a couple of first rounders perform well. We'll see some guys that was called up in the draft. We'll see a couple of those guys. We'll remember some of the names. Oh, he got drafted this year. But look at the way these undrafted rookie free agents are coming to the NFL. They are making a difference. And a lot of these guys are coming from where? G5 programs. If I'm not mistaken, we, the Pittsburgh Steelers, broke the mold and took a G5 program guy in our draft picks. So give it up for South Dakota State. They're developing talent. North Dakota State is developing talent. Tulane Green Wave, developing talent. Toledo Rockets, developing talent. Ohio, developing talent. And I speak on Ohio, I'm talking Ohio Bobcats. Miami of Ohio, where Ben Roethlisberger come from, develops talent. See, that's where you get those games. That's where we're going to get the old college football games. When you was watching the NFL and then we wanted to watch college football because the kids weren't getting paid and they were out there to play to get to the NFL. Now we get to enjoy more of FCS football, HBCU football. See, there's not a lot of money in the HBCU culture. So when we're watching the MEAC, the SWAC, these guys are out there balling. They're really playing ball. Everybody's on that field is giving 100%. Not 50, because they're not touching the ball. 100%. And that's why I like, let's go back to North Carolina State, because I saw that kind of play in it. It's spring game or not. But that's what you're getting from the G5 programs. Now, to get back to talking about the bowl game with Tulane, they were supposed to be one of the best defenses in G5, if I'm not mistaken, last year. Everybody thought that Tulane was going to roll over a Virginia Tech team that had been struggling and really got the ball rolling kind of late, 6-6. Tulane being 9-3. Oh, Tulane's about to roll over them. They got the defense. Their run defense is the top run defense in AAC, the American Athletic Conference. So everybody is so hyped up. And then guess what happens? Kyren Drones started raining. The ball's kind of slick. Can't complete. We didn't complete passes. And nobody thought that they were going to run the ball against Tulane effectively, but they did. They did. And they attacked right at their strongest defense alignment. They picked and picked and prodded and picked. And Kyren Drones had a field day. That read option, if I'm lying, I'm flying. I'm telling you, Kyren Drones was the man in that game. That read option looked perfect. Go back and watch it. Type it in right now. Soon, right now, you could come back and watch me. Press pause on me. Load it up, like it. Or soon as this is done, go and watch the game. It's up on Tube. Virginia Tech and Tulane. Bowl game. Check it out. And watch Kyren Drones. And you tell me he does not remind you of Jalen Hurts. Remind. Keyword is remind. Okay. All right. So we can move on now. And last but not least, before we get on up out of here, shout out to my dog, Shad1419. Y'all go check him out, man. And y'all make sure, hey, please go check my dog out. And by the way, and go check out my OG, South Coast Kane, South. Just like it sounds, South Coast Kane, Cane, and Shad 1419. SSHAD 1419. And make sure, and if you're at Miami's Hurricanes and you want to know about that, they get into the history of it. They have a round table. Sometimes I'm invited to the round table with the Canes, and sometimes I miss out on it. But it's Miami Hurricanes fans talk. They go around and they have great conversations about the Miami Hurricanes. And they're not homers. They're realists. I would say they're Miami Hurricanes realists. They're not super biased on their teams. But they're not going to let you come in there and just talk about the Hurricanes. That's not going to happen. Don't think you're going over there to just talk about it. That's not going to happen. But they will listen to your points. Now, when they come back strong and probably get you, probably will cook you. But they probably turn into a hurricane and sweep you right up. Who knows? But their content is great. And go check them out. You know, a lot up on that. So this rankings, if you follow me right now, in the 2025 NFL Draft Wide Receiver rankings as they stand as today on paper. Now, I think this list will change, honestly, during this college season. I think this list will change dramatically. I mean, dramatically might be an overreach, right? in this list, but I do think this list will change. Okay. And in some of the some sorts, I think there's going to be 3 to 4 receivers that will creep up into this list and become a top 10 receiver before the college season is out. So stick with me. We're going to get the names. If you're on YouTube, you can see them. If you can't, I'll talk about it. Okay. So we'll start from the bottom. Okay. We'll go to 10-1. Okay. So, and this is PFF list, by the way. So Torrey Holton, Colorado State. Absolute monster. First time we got to see him, it was national TV, ESPN, Colorado State overtime game. He was a slant. Here come a slant. Here come drag. Here we go, slant. Here we go, drag. Here we go, slant. Here we go, drag. Here we go, slant. Here we go, drag. Here we go, slant. Drag. Kind of a tune there, right? Nah. But nah, that's when we got to see him, right? And he's a good receiver. Big, I think 14, right? Can't forget that number. Killing him. But it wasn't just him. It wasn't just Colorado. It's other guys. It was other guys. And he performs well. Now, Evan Stewart, up at Oregon. Didn't Evan Stewart come from Texas A&M? Is that where he came? I think so. I think no. Okay. Anyhow, Evan Stewart at Oregon. We know that Dylan Gabriel's up at Oregon, and we know Kelly, the coordinator, about Ohio State. But Oregon, what is Dan Lanning going to do with Evan Stewart? He's on the list, number 9. Yeah, I might think it might be another Oregon receiver. I don't quote me on that. But Evan Stewart's on the list, and he's good. So, you know, he's definitely good. I think he'll do well up there in the Big Ten. We'll wait and see with that one. He's speedy. I want to see more about him. As crazy as this sounds, I want to see. We're talking route runners. Torrey Holton from Colorado State as a route runner. Evan Stewart routes, okay. Speed, yes. We'll see what he has to offer. Isaiah Bond, another one of those flyers. And shout out to the Longhorns, Texas Longhorns. Just see him on the back wall. It's another one of those guys, I think, that has to work on that kind of thing. Look, this is just my opinion. It's just my opinion. Okay, you might see something else. You might think that his route running is incredible. You might think his route running is incredible. No, his route running is incredible. His hands is like this. Or no, his hands is... Look, if you're agreeing with me all the time, then I'm not doing my job right, right? That's just me, though. And everybody could work on route running. Everybody. You can't be too much of a good route runner, but I want to see him... I like to know the defenses and know where you're at, right? And see, by these guys leaving and being at new teams in a new offense is like, this is why this is for me, right? This is why these questions, it's not easy to pick up on the offense. It's going to be some struggles there. See, if you know your offense and you know how to read a defense. So even though you know how to read a defense, okay, so I see this defense coming up, but I don't really know this offense. So if I'm coming out of my break this way, my quarterback's in pressure in the scramble drill, where do I sit in the zone in this offense? I don't want to bump into one of my receivers. When you see that on the field and you see that often in college football, that's because they don't know where to be at in the playbook. Okay, so it's okay to say that. All right, and Antoine Wells Jr., Ole Miss, coming over from South Carolina. Look, I thought he was about to have an incredible year last year. Spencer Rattler absolutely missed him. When he went down, I think that's when Jaheim Bell had made the choice. Jaheim Bell was like, right, I'm going to Florida. I'm not messing around this year. Spencer Rattler, I think I'm still big on Spencer Rattler. They say he was overly confident. I think he was just had to do some maturing, and it humbled him. And I believe that he's going to wind up being one of a top 10 quarterback and a top top 10 is that's a little reach, right? I'm grabbing for something here, but I'll say that Spencer Rattler will be a top 15 quarterback once he gets on the field in the NFL and he's starting. Spencer Rattler will be a name that you'll be like, okay, he'll have his respect in the NFL. He'll definitely be that because he's there. He'll have that respect and he will win some games and he'll be a quarterback that you'll say, I don't want to face him on Sunday. You know what I mean? I don't want to face a Spencer Rattler team on Sunday. Who knows? He might be one of the greats. But what I'm going to say and be safe to say right now is that Spencer Rattler will be a top 15 quarterback in the NFL when he starts. Yes, I believe that strongly. I'm glad that I wish the Steelers would have picked him, but he's down in New Orleans and that's okay. All right. He likes the South. Okay. Xavier Restrepo. You got to say it like that. Restrepo. Man, I honestly think that when I watched film on him and I was like, I'm kind of, look, if I'm being honest, right? They definitely got him in the top five, right? He's number six, right? According to this list. Definitely should be in the top five, number five, to me. It could be, when you in company with other guys on this list that I'm about to name, it's pretty good, right? But what I saw out of Xavier Restrepo was his ball control was crazy. Like for him to get to the 50-50 ball, tough catches. His route running can get everybody. Like I said, everybody's route running could get better, but his was on point. Because he plays fast, but I don't think he's a speedy guy. That makes sense. Okay. And he had to use what he had to get open, awareness and everything else. And he was getting to some balls that was thrown behind him, in front of him. The grabs, his hands are great. Xavier Restrepo in Miami and Cam Ward, that hookup is going to be undeniable. Undeniable. I'm praying that he stays healthy because if we're going to watch the Miami Hurricanes this season and our eyes will be glued on them, they are going to give us a show. Restrepo and Ward. Remember the names. I said it here. Alec Ainomaner from Stanford. The right receiver that went off Colorado. I'm sorry. I skipped the name. I'm so sorry for that. But we got to talk about this guy. He's at number four. I skipped number five. I don't know why. It was the first name I popped up when I looked at the screen. That's exactly why it happened. But he really got his big name when he went off from his 300 yards against Colorado University, Travis Hunter guarding him. And everybody got their kryptonite. And I guess he was just Travis Hunter's kryptonite. The body size, the type, the way that he knew how to use his body. His speed, you didn't think that he was a speedy guy, bigger guy, knew how to use his route running. Look, man, he's going to be a problem. He is going to be a problem. I'm hoping that Stanford has a somewhat successful season, but I'm not, the way that NIL is, I don't know if Alec Ainomaner will stay there. But look, it could because to me, education is more important than anything. He's a Canadian guy. I'm thinking that he'll finish off his career with Stanford because Stanford is a very prestigious school when it comes to education. And you're gaining some kind of a degree has validity to it when you go to a Stanford. So I believe he'll stay at Stanford. I would hope so because he will know some very smart, powerful people that will go into society and hold high grade level jobs that know people, that know some people, that know some people. So I hope that you would build those relationships there, Alec and Omeyer, and just be the great receiver that you are. But that game right there really put him on the map. From after that, people were like, we got to watch him. Nobody could do nothing with him. You can't do nothing with him. He's beat some of the best cornerbacks. He, like I said, gave Travis Hunter problems. Problems. You hear me? And not just him. He did it to everybody who lined up on the opposite side of him. Period. Period. And his quarterback was young. We'll see what they do this year. That's another exciting hookup to look at. Travis Hunter from Colorado University. I got to give him a big round of applause because I skipped my guy. I skipped him. And for that, I get a... Yeah, I know. I got to get a... Yeah, I know. I know, y'all. I didn't mean to miss him. Dang. Okay. All right. Chill. But Travis Hunter. Colorado University. Some people say, why is Travis Hunter on this list? He's going to the NFL as a cornerback. No, he's not. So you think that. Travis Hunter is a wide receiver who can play cornerback. He is not a cornerback that can play wide receiver. No. He is a wide receiver that can play cornerback. I'm convinced. Me and my co-host actually sat down and we debated this. And I was on the other side. I must say that. And by me saying that, I'm standing on business. But look, so I'm looking at Travis Hunter as a cornerback, and I'm like, look, Alec and Omeyer kind of showed us that. People say, oh, he just came back from injury. Yeah, but he had a 150-yard game and two tutties that same game. So you can't blame that. And he shouldn't be on the field both ways. Because if he's conserving his energy and he's not on the field that much, you're going to get one heck of a dynamic receiver, a unstoppable receiver, Colorado. I know we want Travis Hunter to play both ways. He can do it. I know it. Put him on kickoff, punt return. I don't know. I know we want to see that, but I'm telling you, if Travis Hunter is not on defense as much as he is and he's playing offense, nobody can guard Travis Hunter. He's unguardable. You can't guard him. You can't. And you're probably not going to get beat him for the ball. The ball is in his circumference. It's coming down with him. But he's just his. It's like he has eagle eyesight. And if he's sitting in a zone, he's a great corner. So what I would say is, if it's a passing down, I don't know, 37, if you're in a red zone, if the team's on a 30-yard line creeping up on the red zone, I would put Travis Hunter at cornerback then, somewhere where he can sit in a zone. But man-to-man, we saw kind of what man-to-man did, and we saw what kind of the man zone did too. We saw that. Like some people said, well, he was in a zone when Alec and Omeyer beat him. Regardless, that was his guy. That was his assignment. Alec Omeyer was his assignment. We seen that. We seen him sit in the zone and pick things off. He's like, you just got to use him. Look, no matter what I'm saying, no matter what you have to say about what I'm saying, it comes down to Coach Prime and their coordinator, Robert Livingston, to know how to and when to use Travis Hunter on defense. That's Travis Hunter would be the guy that I want to put in there to stop on a third down, red zone effectiveness. I don't want him on the field both ways. If they're on a 20-yard line and we kicked it off, Colorado kicks it off, the team kneels, I don't want Travis Hunter on the field right then and there. No. If they cross the 50, then I'll put Travis on the field. You get what I'm saying? Conserve that energy. He's a better receiver than he is cornerback. Just look it up. See what he do. See what he do. I know he can pick the ball off, and he will. But put him in the right situations to win. Conserve that energy because he's unguardable on offense. He's just unguardable. You know what I mean? Who says, you know what I mean? They're running a sweep with a big old Jonah Coleman type of running back coming at him. You got Ollie Gordon coming over Travis Hunter at corner. Travis Hunter steps up, try to tackle Ollie Gordon. Ollie Gordon runs him over. Boom. On defense. What then? Like, and he gets hurt. Like, now you one down receiver. Like, use him when you need him on defense. Don't just start on both ways. I would say that. You know what I mean? That's all I'm saying. I don't wish that on nobody, but I'm just saying. I think it's smart to do that. And if you think so, give me a thumbs up in the comments. So, Emeka Egbuka, Ohio State. Yo, crazy work. Crazy work. These top three to me are great route runners. They are NFL ready right now. I believe they can go and be effective on an NFL team right now. Right now. So Will Howard and Egbuka is about to go crazy out there at Ohio State. His route running is just crazy. It is. A lot of people say Marvin Harrison. That's who they were trying to guard. That's who they were trying to shut down. Egbuka. Let's just call it what it is. Like, I'm just saying, I'm not saying Maserati Marv wasn't good. I didn't say that. I didn't say Maserati. I'm telling y'all, Egbuka is what the other teams were really, really trying to stop. Ask the coach. Ask any coach. Go ahead and ask them in the Big Ten. Guaranteed to say it. McMillan, Arizona. Crazy. I've seen some crazy videos on him catching crazy catches. I've just seen him give every cornerback in the Pac-12 problems last year. Every single cornerback. Everybody got that work from him. Everybody. Favita, his quarterback Noah, Favita, and McMillan will be an unstoppable tandem. All I have to say is the 2 and 3 receiver at Arizona, be ready to have some catches. Be ready because y'all going to get a lot of work because they are going to try to double and triple team McMillan. Period. That's what I have to say about that. Luther Burton, the third. Let's go. He's the third like I am. Listen. There ain't a cornerback. I don't care. There ain't a cornerback in college that can guard Luther Burton III. There ain't. He's only getting better. There ain't. He knows the college system. He knows the system that Mizzou runs. Every coach game plans to stop him. Believe that. And they still couldn't stop him. And they're game planning to stop him and to minimize his playing ability. And they can't. That's why he's at the top of this list. Because every SEC coach that faced the Missouri Tigers and every coach who faced them has told a source in some kind of sports magazine, in the sports culture, Burton III is a problem. Is a problem. I had one underneath him, one spy, 2 in the background, an Inspector Gadget, and I still couldn't stop him. Telling you, he's a problem. All right, man, I enjoyed doing this, man. It took me so long to get through this. I really did. I had a wonderful, great time. I didn't even mean to turn this into like a show of a sorts, but it just happened that way. And I enjoyed it. I enjoy y'all watching me. I hope y'all enjoyed it and listening. Wherever you at, make sure you give me a 5-star review and a good review. Hit the like button. Subscribe to the channel if you're new here. Get down in the comments. Until next time, y'all, you know how we doing it. My father,
Saturday, 6:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 3:30 p.m. Pacific Time. But in the meantime, in between time, enjoy the content. Don't forget to hit your notification bell for all updates. Thank you for watching.